place in your car is probably more getting crowded. It's much more expensive. And last year, there were events about that. And every year since they get the rule, they've found other ways to get around. And they're almost back in the same level.
And it was in, yeah, it was in Atlanta.
Getting to your senior level.
Good to see you. You all right? Hello, Josh. Good. Very nice to see you. Who are you?
Thank you all very much for coming out tonight. My name is William Perry with Common Cause Georgia. Just wanted to make a quick announcement. We are beginning the book signing. And so if you are interested in purchasing a book, they're available for purchase for $20, cash, check, or charge. We'll start the line right back here, and we're going to allow that to happen for about 20 minutes or so, as long as we can get everybody who would like one covered. We'll continue the 60 Minutes video here if you haven't had the chance to see it yet. But also just wanted to let you know, if you wanted to get up and get a drink or a bite of food before we get started with the program, you'll have about 15 or 20 minutes to be able to do that. Restrooms are available right over there on the other side of the bar. And anything you need, grab me, grab Rachel. And Ryan's in the back, so he's hiding. So we'll take the questions, answers, all that kind of stuff. So we'll be back in about 15 or 20 minutes. Thank you.
Jack Abramoff was a whiz at influencing legislation, and one way he did that was to get his clients, like some Indian tribes, to make substantial campaign contributions to select members of Congress.
Signing table until everybody who has had the opportunity to get one has gotten one, and we'll make sure it is signed for you. But first, let me say, for those who I haven't met yet, my name is William Perry. I'm the executive director of Common Cause Georgia, and we're just thrilled to have you all out tonight. We're quite surprised that we had such a great turnout tonight, so thank you all very much for being a part of it. I want to introduce somebody who's going to kind of give us a quick update on the bill that the Georgia Alliance for Ethics Reform or the issue that we've been working on for now three legislative sessions. The Georgia Alliance of Ethics Reform is made up of Common Cause Georgia, the League of Women Voters of Georgia, Georgia Tea Party Patriots, and the Georgia Georgia Conservatives in Action. And we've built up a nice coalition of left and right groups who are pushing hard for ethics reform, but we couldn't do it without somebody inside the legislature working on our issues hand in hand with us, putting our ideas into bills and into legislation and trying to push those to pass. We're fortunate to have a gentleman that I've dubbed the Ethics Terminator, because he just keeps coming back and coming back and will not be defeated until we get the things that we are all fighting so hard for. So I want to call on him for a few minutes to come up, Senator Josh McCoon from Columbus, Georgia. Senator McCoon?
Thank you very much. Before I take just a moment or two to give you an idea of where we are in the legislature, I do want to say a word about William Perry specifically. Everybody that's involved, all the different grassroots organizations, are the reason why we are even in the debate that we have right now. But every time I came to William with an idea over the last year and a half, like I said to him towards the end of session last year, I said, you know, William, it'd be a great idea for us to drive all over Georgia right at the end of July and go to 14 different cities and talk about this issue. And he said, that sounds great. Let's go do that. And then when we got through and had such a good result on the primary, we started talking as a group about what we could do leading up to session. What if we had 9 more town hall meetings and just went all over the state and maybe did one every 2 or 3 days? He said, yeah, let's do that. Let's set it up. Let's make it happen. And so I'm tremendously grateful to William and his staff for all the logistical support that they have given for us to be able to keep this issue alive. Because where we were last year was that a bill was introduced in the House and a bill was introduced in the Senate, and we did not get one committee hearing. There was no formal debate of this issue whatsoever. As a matter of fact, I was told that, you know, you bring forward this bill, you know, your political career is going to be over, you can forget about it. And what a difference a year makes. Now where we are is that the House has passed 2 different bills, and the one that I want to spend my time on is House Bill 142. This is the bill that deals with the gift limit issue and some other collateral issues that are part of the wider ethics reform. And I just want to say to you, I don't want there to be any confusion about this, and most of the people in this crowd I know are well informed and follow this issue very closely, but the House bill is window dressing. I was in a meeting this morning, and the way I described it is this. The House bill is like if you have a group of rambunctious kids who have taken over their parents' house and are making a lot of noise, and the neighbors complain. The House bill is basically not to do anything about the party, just to move it down the street. And that's really what it's going to do. It would continue to allow unlimited giving. It would reduce the level of transparency because the giving would be by committee or caucus or subcommittee, or there's even a provision in there that I call the caucus to be named later provision, where either House's ethics committee can sign off on a caucus. So I could have the Josh McCoon dinner caucus, and if I got a majority of the ethics committee to sign off on it, we could go off and be entertained, and it would be unlimited. So the good news is, however, that they have passed an ethics bill, and it is now crossed over to the Senate. And it is my expectation that the Senate is going to put language into House Bill 142 that everyone in this room can be extremely proud of, to get behind, to support. And that's kind of where we are. What I would encourage all of you to do is follow this very closely. You have such an opportunity to influence so many people that aren't in this room on this issue and to keep them informed, because we are going to have a lot of action. We were talking earlier. We think this is something that's going to go down to the wire. It's something that will probably wind up in a conference committee. And so it's going to take a lot of pressure from the outside coming in for us to get the result that we want. But I'm tremendously grateful, as I said, to everyone in this room, particularly to those that have been at the Capitol every day, trying to keep the legislature honest. That is a tough, it is a tough job to take on, and I really appreciate the efforts that have been made. I do want to say one word about the program that you're going to have here in a moment before I turn it back over to William. I had the opportunity to hear Mr. Abramoff at the National Conference of State Legislatures annual meeting in Chicago last August. His story is a profound one. It is one that is just, it was very eye-opening for me. I hope that you will take the opportunity to read his book. It is an incredible, I read it in a single day. I could not put it down. Just the stories that are told, and it answers the question that we were asked so much in the last 2 years, which is, you know, we have some ethics legislation in Georgia. It's fine. You know, we're 50th in the nation, but that's okay. Why do we need, you know, why do we need ethics legislation? That's what we were asked over and over again. I mean, we have ethical people in the legislature. We don't need ethics laws. Well, I think if you listen to his presentation tonight, you're going to understand why it is so critically important that we have these laws, and that things are very clearly spelled out, and that there is a bright line. So again, thank you for the opportunity to speak, and I'll turn it back over to William.
Thank you, Senator McCoon. I think we have a few empty seats. I thought I spotted some from the back. Is there an empty seat next to anyone? If you could raise your hand. We've got one tucked over here in the corner. The one tucked over in the corner, if somebody'd really like a seat, come claim it right over here. There you go, good call. Went to the highest bidder. I want to first start off by recognizing the fact that we actually had to in capacity. We're actually over capacity and couldn't let more people in. So I think this is the first time Common Cause Georgia has ever completely sold out an event, or at least filled capacity. So that's quite a testament to our guest speaker and someone who's really helped us out, really blast our message loud and clear today. I first want to thank someone who made tonight possible, and that's Ray Boyd. Who, Ray, could you raise your hand? I'm not, Mr. Ray Boyd. Say he's a citizen activist is an understatement. He is a superhero citizen activist who never takes no for an answer. And fortunately, when I called him, he said yes to help us with the sponsorship of this event. And Ray, we truly appreciate it because you really helped us blast the message out. So thank you so much. We've learned really quick that to get ahead on any of our issues, we've got to have a very loud voice. I think Common Cause, for a while, a lot of us and some of the other groups kind of sat in the corner and we made some suggestions. And we learned over the years that that often does not get us where we need to be. And so we started collectively making a much louder voice and started really pushing this issue forward. And we would really like to ask every one of you to kind of help join our collective voice. If you have a seat, then you've got cards on these seats. If you don't have a seat and you don't have a card, have no fear. Before you leave, you will have one. And this will tell you a little bit about our work. It also has an opportunity for you to sign up as a member. Membership starts out $15 for students and kind of goes on up to a family membership. And then we've also got a card you can sign for both your state senator and your state representative that we will be glad to deliver for you to let them know about this issue and what we feel like needs to be real, meaningful ethics reform. And I thank Senator McCoon for covering the issue for us about what's come out of the House so far. And we're always caught in kind of a tricky place. We always need to recognize that people who haven't been with us all along are starting to take steps, that they may be baby steps, but finally they are taking steps in the right direction. But we just need a little bit of help to kind of get them a little further along. I kind of think about this issue and I think about the old Eddie Murphy line, where he says, if you're starving,
and somebody throws you a cracker, it's going to be the best cracker you've ever had. You're probably going to ask, wow, is that a saltine cracker or possibly a Ritz? So I think we've been tossed a cracker and we've devoured it, but we're hungry for more. And we've got to get this right. Ethics comes up. The last significant ethics legislation was passed 21 years ago. You hear the floor speech out of the House and people go on and on about how every few years we have an ethics reform bill. Well, that might be so, but we haven't had real ethics reform in an awfully long time. And I think we're on the cusp of getting that, and we need help from every one of you to do that. And thankfully, again, Senator McCoon, thank you for being our lead dog in that fight in the legislature. I've gone on enough, so I'm real anxious to introduce our guest speaker, who I just couldn't imagine after watching the interviews and even reading the book and really not being able to know somebody until you really get a chance to look them in the eye and shake their hand and spend a little time with them. But I gotta say, I've just so quickly become a huge Jack Abramoff fan. He's been incredibly generous with his time down here with us. He worked with us as a small nonprofit organization to be able to bring him down here. And it just really means a lot for our organization, for our partners, and for our movement, for somebody of his level and experience and the message that he's delivering to come and join us. And I know many of you bought the book. If you haven't, at the end, we'll definitely make sure you have the opportunity. But I just wanted to read real quick, and I'm completely stealing this idea from a young lady, Rachel Tobin, who's on the board of directors of the Atlanta Press Club. She read this little excerpt today, and I was like, I've got to read that because I think it kind of sums up the man that I've met. In describing himself, he said, he majored in English literature with the goal of becoming a lawyer and took advantage of as many Jewish studies courses as I could find, including Hebrew language and Jewish law. My other academic focus confused all but my mother. I minored in opera. I was a powerlifting, football-playing, Orthodox Jewish right-wing Republican opera buff. And he ends that with, you know the type. So I'm extremely pleased to now know the type that is Jack Abramoff.
William. Don't worry, I won't be singing an aria. It was analytical opera. Can you imagine how exciting that was to everyone? Well, to me, I enjoyed it. But William, I spent the day with you. We spent a few weeks getting the trip organized. And I have to tell you all what you already know, how fortunate you are to have William Perry. The last time I was here in Atlanta, I spoke, and I actually spoke to an FBI training seminar. It wasn't exactly the same kind of audience, I assume. Afterward, I was speaking to some of the folks involved with that group, and they mentioned that, unfortunately, in their view, Georgia had one of the most difficult and least invasive ethics regimes. And then I went from there, and I'm pretty much every week speaking somewhere, and I went from there to Texas. And I spoke in Austin at the State House and to the University of Texas. And some of the folks came up to me and said that they're doing everything they can to improve the situation in Texas, but at least they're not Georgia. And then I went to California, and I spoke in Los Angeles, and there were legislators there at the group I spoke at from the Southwest, from Arizona, from New Mexico, some from Western Texas, and from Nevada, and we were talking about the ethics rules and lobbyists and get bans, and they said, well, we're all working very hard in our states, but at least we're not Georgia. And so when William made contact with me, I felt pretty bad for him. They had a common cause in Georgia. I figured he was under assault constantly. And I wondered, would it be safe to go down and be with William? Maybe, maybe I needed a flak jacket or something. But then I came down, and we have spent the day together. And I got to hear about the work you're doing, Senator McCune, and I'm amazed by it. The bravery to be able to, as chairman of a judiciary committee, to stand up for these kind of issues is extraordinary. And it's not just, and in Georgia, I'm saying anywhere in the country, it's very, very rare to find somebody of not only moral and intellectual courage like you have, but in the face of what is clearly great opposition and a culture perhaps that isn't used to the kind of reforms that you have been putting forward and understand need to be put forward is quite extraordinary, and it's a huge honor. And I know that you're all delighted to be able to have such a senator and such a representative, Representative Spencer, I'm not sure where over there, and the others who join you. And it is rare. And to be honest with you, when I started hearing from William about the progress that was being made here, I was very surprised. And I still wanted to go back to Texas and Arizona and all these cities. Hey, what do you mean Georgia? Look what they're doing. And I know it's not exactly, the bill's not exactly where it needs to be, but it's extraordinary and it's laudatory and it's something which I think ultimately Georgia, thanks to your efforts and those Kay and others who work on this and push this, and Tea Party patriots and League of Women Voters, and certainly Common Cause, that soon people will be able to say, look at Georgia, this is what we have to do. And I strongly hope and encourage that you will keep pushing the envelope and push it to solution. You know, my story is a tumultuous one. I've been through an interesting voyage. Look, I put myself on the voyage. Nobody put a gun to my head and said, go be a lobbyist, go over the line, go push the envelope, and go do things that you later would regret. I did all those things on my own, and I paid a price for it. I paid a price that included, you know, not only losing everything we had and winding up in a federal prison for a very long period of time, but also the sort of international ignominy that comes with this whole deal. I was happily a private citizen, figuring nobody would ever be able to pronounce my last name, let alone spell it, and just busily working away. And then one day I woke up as a consequence again of me and what I did, and was on the front pages of newspapers and thrust into the middle of a scandal of my own making and the making of those with me, that just kept growing and growing and growing, and was confusing at times to me. I mentioned earlier today, I went through the various phases, you know, of why is this happening to me? What did I do that's so bad? And this will blow over. It's Washington. Everybody has ADD. Nobody remembers anything tomorrow. And on and on and on until I was able to, thank God, sort of work my way through to more of the truth, I guess, than I was willing to admit back in those days. And it was difficult because I entered politics back in college. I went to Brandeis University in Massachusetts, and Brandeis was a weird place for a conservative Republican, to be honest with you. It was the Republican Club. We met in, well, we didn't quite need a phone booth for our meetings, but the two of us, you know, used to get together. And they assigned me, when I got to Brandeis, they assigned me Angela Davis's dorm room. I don't know if you remember Angela Davis. Angela Davis was a perennial candidate of the Communist Party USA for vice president with Gus Hall. May he rest in peace, she went to Brandeis. And Abby Hoffman went to Brandeis. It was not exactly a place where right-wingers go. But I went to Brandeis. And at Brandeis, I got involved in College Republicans. Again, there wasn't a lot of competition to rise within that organization. And I continued and got involved politically and moved to Washington. I met, when I was in Massachusetts, a fellow who went to Harvard Business School at that time. And we were working, I'm ashamed to say, in the Carter Center. We were working for the election of Ronald Reagan in 1980. In Massachusetts, you can imagine how much fun that was. And his name was Grover Norquist, and you may have heard that name. And he heads the America's Taxi Forum now, and he was with me in College Republicans. And we were able to somehow win Massachusetts for Reagan. Back then, mainly just by outworking the other side. We just worked very hard, we organized, we found every Republican on college campuses in Massachusetts, all 12 of them, and we got, actually there were several thousand, we got them organized, and I then ran for national chairman of College Republicans with Grover as my executive director. We went there, and a young boy in his teens, I think, and he certainly looked like he was about 6 years old, named Ralph Reed, came up to me at that convention and said he wanted to come work for us. And we couldn't afford to pay him more than $100 a month. Grover, with a Harvard MBA, was making $1,000 a month. I think he still holds the record for worst post-MBA Harvard job with us. So Ralph lived on my couch, ate spaghetti every night because that was the cheapest food he could eat. And we all worked together, and there was another fellow who was there as the chairman before me, named Carl Rove. And so this was sort of the nascent beginnings of some of the Republican troublemakers that some of y'all have been able to deal with since. And I spent my time there, moved on to President Reagan's lobby, and as mentioned earlier today, encountered my first corruption in Washington, where a congressman who was a Democrat called me in, and we were working the MX missile. I don't know if you remember that one. We were trying to get the MX missile approved, and I was head of President Reagan's lobby. We were doing the vote counts, and we were six votes short, and I was called into this congressman's office, who was the one of the leaders in the Hispanic caucus, and he promised us 13 votes if he got a missile base in his district. And that was sort of the first taste for me of how Washington works. Well, I didn't get too many more tastes. I went off to become a movie producer, actually. The natural progression, of course, from politics. Well, for Republicans, because don't forget, Reagan was an actor, became a politician. This is what Republicans are busy doing. So I went off to be a movie producer. I sort of got out of it for a while and came back in 94. And in 94, when the Republicans did very well and won the Congress, I became a lobbyist. And but a different kind of lobbyist, not the kind of lobbyist I was working on sort of public policy matters, but a lobbyist working for clients. And I learned the business, and I built a practice, and in building the practice started to accumulate more and more clients and more people who worked for me, and hired more and more people off Capitol Hill to be lobbyists, and ultimately got up to, I guess, about 40 lobbyists who worked for me, and we built the practice to be the number one practice in D.C., for better or for worse. And ultimately, the taste of winning became so important, the taste of defeat we didn't have. We only lost one time in 10 years. And that, I mentioned earlier, also, that's a problem. That's a problem. In fact, when I speak to the FBI and the DOJ training schools, invariably they do questions at the end. They say, from their perspective, how do we detect when there's a problem in the lobbying business? How what should we be looking for? And so what you should look for is somebody who doesn't lose. Because you can't not lose. It doesn't make sense in politics. I mean, you can't win everything, right, Senator? I mean, you don't win everything. So we were winning everything. Now, were we winning everything because we were just paying off everybody? No, of course not. We were working hard. But we were, unfortunately, deeply enmeshed in a system of corruption in Washington that's so endemic to the system and so unbelievably important as a part of the system that most people who are involved in it not only don't realize that they're doing something wrong, but they think they're doing everything right. And unfortunately, to some degree, I was that person. And that's a bigger problem, actually, if you think about it, than somebody who thinks I'm doing wrong. Somebody who thinks they're doing wrong goes home at night, and maybe one night they'll say, I can't take this anymore. I've got to stop this. I've got to change. But somebody who thinks they're doing right, they never have that moment. They never have that moment. And so I never had that moment until I was dead. It took, unfortunately for me, I wish I could say otherwise, but it took for me to get my head cut off, to finally sit back and realize, what am I doing? And when I did, it was mortifying. It was mortifying. It was after my scandal started, and I was being pilloried on the front page of the Washington Post almost every day. I was on the front page of the Post 300 times. 300 times. Now, I was on the front page of the Post. This is the paper of the most political city in the nation. I was on the front page of the Post more than John Kerry was when he was running for president. Think about that. So while that was going on, and it wasn't great, obviously it didn't feel very good. Doesn't feel great to see yourself in the newspaper negatively day after day. The only good thing about it is eventually you develop such a hard, thick skin that, you know, it's like, whatever. You know, my wife, God bless her, she never developed that skin. She just canceled the subscription of the paper. And so eventually, you know, we used to get the Washington Post, the New York Times, the Washington Times, and the Wall Street Journal. And eventually I came home, there's no papers. So what's going on here? And the TVs are gone, and the radio's pulled out of the wall. What's happening? He said, I don't hear any of this. I don't want to know about this. And in fact, until I got out of prison, my wife actually never read a newspaper and never watched television, except for Downton Abbey probably or something like that. But didn't none of that. And the kids and whatever. I, of course, was fiendishly watching every article, pulling thanks to the internet every morning. I had, you know, the Google alert, right? So I'd have, you know, a whole inbox full of hits on me, and I would put them all in the folder. Now, I started this when the scandal started, thinking this will blow over, and okay, these are some articles about me, I should just keep them, so I have them. By the time I went to prison, there were 10,000 separate articles, different articles, not like AP puts out a thing, there's 500 copies, 10,000 separate articles. So it was very difficult for us, and for me in particular, and my family. But in the process of going through a lot of pain, I'm very fortunate that I was able to start analyzing myself, which I didn't like what I saw, and the system. And for myself, it was important because there was no way for me to try to repair myself, try to work on turning it around. And look, I've been trying to turn it around every day since that day. But to change a characteristic, to change your essence, is very difficult. It's very difficult. And to work on that and to struggle and to fight is a daily thing. It's like my constant losing battle with dieting, you know, only it's more serious than dieting. At least it was more serious for me. And so that was me. And I continue to hope and try to do that. But more important at a certain other level was the system. And all the things that Common Cause stands for, and a lot of other reform groups in DC stood for, all those things, I basically, when I thought about them, I disdained them. I thought, oh, they're just silly people. What are they talking about? They're gonna change rules? Come on. You know, we have the power, the lobbyists, the congressmen who support us. They're not gonna change anything, and guess what? They didn't. They didn't. They still haven't. We still haven't in D.C. There are some changes. They make some modifications. They move some of the chairs around on the ship. But the ship is still going where it's going. And my thought process was I started going through that. And I started to not only be sorry that I was part of that system, but be really upset that that system is our system. Where is this from? Where did this come from? Certainly nobody of good will in our country wants this, but yet it's there. It's a system where we have, sorry to say, legalized bribery. We have a legalized system where somebody like me could take, as I did, millions of dollars a year, because I had unlimited funds at my fingertips with my clients, and get results. Maybe not with just making contributions and going and giving gifts and whatnot. There were legislative strategies, there were battles, there were this or that, and we worked hard on those fronts too. But there's something wrong with a system where that is the outcome. And where not only that's going on, but everybody up there feels that they're pure as the driven snow. That they're not being bribed, they're not being impacted. You know, I can't tell you how many times I heard, I wouldn't sell my vote for $2,500 contribution. I don't sell my vote for tickets to the Washington Wizards. I mean, that all right, I get. All right. But I wouldn't sell my vote for going to play golf. That's not me. And they believe it. And you can strap them to a lie detector test and they'll pass. And you put a Bible in front of them, they'll put their hand on it. And they believe it, but they're wrong. They're wrong. And it's not a couple people. It's not everybody. There are a few exceptions. But far too many have become cozy with this, have become okay with it, have become okay with it in the same way that I was okay with it. In the same way that I fancied myself a religious person, I fancy myself, I have a bunch of clients who I took on. I rejected clients, by the way. When a client came to me with an issue where I disagreed, and generally they were foreign powers where I disagreed, I rejected them. And one of them came to me, a certain Middle Eastern country, and offered me twice as much as my highest paying client. And my clients were the highest paying clients in Washington. My clients were millions of dollars a year, and they doubled it, and I turned it down because I didn't want to work for them. So I had a bunch of clients that I thought were great, that I supported their issues, that I basically felt I would die for. I would instruct the people who worked for me along the lines of that which my football coach, one of them in high school, instructed us. One day we went to play a game against a team in California. I grew up in Southern California. We played a school called Inglewood, which is where the old Forum was, where the Lakers used to play. And it was a rivalry situation between our schools, and it happened to be that we were those couple of years, we were playing pretty well. And we beat them with a field goal at the last minute, and you know how kids can sometimes get a little excited, and some threw some rocks and bottles at our bus the year before. And so we came back the next year, and we get in the locker room, and the coach said to us, he said, look out the window. And we looked out the window. Okay, and he said, sit down. So I want to tell you a story. He said there was a Pacific Island chieftain who gathered his guys together and they got on canoes and they went to an island to conduct a war. And when they got there at the beach, he burned all their canoes. And he told them that you're gonna win or die here. So we're a bunch of high school kids were going, yeah, it's a great story for a football game. What does this have to do with anything? He says, your bus is gone. I sent your bus back home. If you lose, you're walking home. This is the place we had rocks and bottles. So we were frenzied, of course. We beat them by 30 points. We were insane. This is why we want to walk back home. So I would tell this to the lobbyists who work for me. And I said, listen, our clients are hiring us to win. They're not hiring us to give them excuses. Lobbyists and lawyers, no offense to either if you're here, because it's not true of everybody, but lobbyists and lawyers are famous for a great spin. Okay? How do we spin the client to tell them why we lost? And my attitude was, we're not going to lose. We're not going to have that conversation, because if we lose, you're all dying on the battlefield. Nobody comes back if we lose. And I think they thought I meant it. So that was our attitude. So a bunch of clients who we thought were great, issues we agreed with, we were gonna die for them. We saved them at the end, I had to add all this up, of course, $6.8 billion charged them about $100 million. And I made for our firm tens of millions of dollars. I made tens of millions of dollars. My wife and I gave 80% of it to charity and other needy causes. And we were happy to do it. We had plenty to live on, and there were a lot of people who needed around us, so we gave it away. So I felt pretty good about everything. All right, I convinced myself that this is great. And I was convinced of that fact until the day came when I said, you know what, I'm getting attacked every day in the paper. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm not the saint I thought I was. Maybe they're right. Maybe the people who I can't stand, the people who are saying terrible things, that I did terrible things, it wasn't Common Cause itself, but a lot of the reform groups even, maybe they're right. And so I started digging into my emails, 850,000 emails that I wrote when I was a lobbyist over those 10 years. I was at diarrhea of the fingers, you know. Everything, every thought that coursed through my little pea brain, I typed up into an email. I did exactly, by the way, what you're told. You know, don't write anything in an email you don't want to read on the front page of the paper. Well, plenty of what I wrote wound up on the front page of the paper and was very entertaining, I think, for a lot of people, just not for me. And so, unfortunately, I was in a situation where, until I came to that epiphany, I figured, all right, what did I do? What's so wrong here? I came to the epiphany, and I started working through the system. And I realized that the system is wrong, and this is horrible, and this is destroying America, and they're right. My critics are right. And that's horrible to come to that realization, by the way. It's not fun to come to that realization. I didn't feel like, oh, good Jack, oh, well, you know, you get it. No, I felt like a jerk on top of the fact that I was being pounded. I now realize I was wrong. And then the time came for me to go to prison. And that was pretty bad, too. So going into prison, I decided that, look, I'm going to go do my time. And when I entered prison, I didn't know how long I'd be there because I wasn't sentenced fully yet. And so I went and entered prison. And I wanted to just do my time and then go away. I didn't want to have any more publicity. I didn't want to have any more articles. I didn't want to have any more to do with the media. Nothing. Just take my children, my wife, and my father. My mother had passed away while I was in prison. And just go away and become anonymous. Oh, in prison, they passed a reform bill called HALOGA. And these initials are great, HALOGA. And HALOGA, honest government, honest leadership in government, whatever. And HALOGA was a good attempt to try to do something on the part of Public Citizen, which is another group that works on these issues. And a guy in Washington named Craig Holman, who's a great guy, and he worked very hard to get a bill through. And when they put the bill through, of course, they changed the bill. And they made it so, you gotta find a little bit of exceptions. We have to have a few exceptions. We can't have a pure bill. So they put through some exceptions. And I got HALOGA. My lawyer mailed me HALOGA in prison. Mail call one knife, in came HALOGA. And I read it. And I thought to myself, if I were a lobbyist, take me, I don't know, a day to get through this. Not read it, to get around it. Okay, to get around it. And I was trying to think, what in my activities of the past would I not be able to do because of HALOGA? And I couldn't come up with anything. And this was the Reform Act because of the Jack Abramoff scandal. So at first I thought, you know, the old Reagan, well, there they go again. You know, that kind of thing, right? But I then started thinking, you know, this is terrible. They're never going to not do this. Reform bills to lobbyists, by the way, just as an aside, reform bills to lobbyists, they're not like they are to everybody else. Everybody else says, oh, well, we're going to clean up the system, we're going to reform things. And there are different kinds of reforms, not just this issue. For example, there was a reform bill called the HAVA Act, or HAVA, Help America Vote Act. Okay? Now, Help America Vote Act was while I was a lobbyist, and the committee it was coming from was the government, Government Operations, I guess, Committee. Bob Ney was the chairman of the committee. He was a friend of mine. So here was a reform bill. Now, when a lobby sees a reform bill, what do they think? They think here comes a what we call a moving train, meaning this is a bill that will get signed. Because since 95, very few things get signed. Very few things make it through the Congress. That's why they're always doing these continuing resolutions. They can't get a budget, they can't get appropriations, they can't get anything. Because they can't agree. But the one thing they agree on is reform bills. So what do lobbyists think of reform bills? They love reform bills. Not because they can reform anything. Of course they're not going to reform anything. Because it's a moving train. Now what do you do? Remember the old days with the trains and the guys and gals jumping into the trains, throwing things into boxcars, and throwing things onto moving trains. That's what lobbyists do. They find a moving train and they try to stick in these bills provisions. So I did this too. I had a tribe I represented in Texas that wanted a casino, and they were prohibited by federal law from having a casino. One of two tribes prohibited from having a casino. And we were trying to get them a casino. So we decided that we would change the law by drafting something so absolutely abstruse that nobody would possibly understand what it is, which is another lobbyist technique, by the way. I mean, I had a guy on my staff whose job was to draft legislation so nobody understood what it meant. And he was very good. So he drafted something like Public Law 119.3, Section 241A is deleted. But what does that mean, right? Of course, none of us know what it means. Said here, people who work in the U.S. Code don't know what it means, unless what? They have the U.S. Code, they go in there, they figure out what it is. That provision, that sentence, was put onto the HAVA, the Help America Vote Act. Help America Vote Act was to overcome the hanging Chad problem. Remember that? Remember 2000, yes. Right? The machines in Florida. You had elderly Jewish folks voting for Pat Buchanan, all right, in wherever, Miami-Dade. Obviously, some issues there. So they had a bill to reverse that. That was the bill. We got that provision onto the bill from the House side. We didn't get it on the Senate side because the senator didn't stay bribed. It was a senator who is in the book, looking there, want to repeat his name out loud. He's not a senator any longer. He's a lobbyist, what a shock. And he indirectly asked for $50,000 for the Democratic Senatorial Committee, and we got it to him. And then he went back on his agreement. Well, it's not like you can take it to court, right? I mean, imagine that lawsuit. He was bribed and didn't stay bribed. You know, what do you do? Right? So that was our failure, by the way. That was the one I mentioned, the one time it didn't work. But that's a reform bill. So now I'm in prison and I see the new reform bill. And I'm sure there were provisions in there, code provisions, that were the same thing that I used to do. I just didn't know what the code was. In prison, they don't have the U.S. code readily available for the inmates to go through. I read it, I kind of shrugged my shoulders, and then I started getting a little upset. I thought, what am I doing here? If at the end of this, if it was such a big problem, if everything that I did was wrong, and it was, what is all of a sudden going on here? Why am I here? If they're not serious about this, why am I in prison? And I thought, the truth is, I need to do something. I need to do something beyond disappearing. I need to do something because I was, to my great shame, in the rooms that a lot of people don't get to go in. I was in the meetings that people think are taking place, but don't get to hear what's going on. I was coming up with dastardly ideas on how to get things done that maybe were worse than the others, even. But they were at least in the same ballpark. And so I know a lot of things that other people know, but those other people are still making money off those things. Those other people are either deceased or still doing it. There's no retire and go become a reformer track in the lobbying world. And maybe instead of taking the easy route of just going ahead and disappearing and frankly going back into making worthless motion pictures, which is sort of what I'm doing. So when they come out, just be warned, if you see my name on them, just, you know. Instead of doing that, maybe I need to tell people what really goes on there. So I wrote this book. And then I made the decision that, all right, more than that. What if I were still a lobbyist? What would really bother me? What would I actually want to stop? And I started making a list of those things. And those things have become the basis of a campaign, which I am working on fairly full-time, in addition to other things I do to try to make it by. And these things are rather draconian. We were talking earlier about having a bill that could really tighten things up and really be a tough bill. Well, this is a bill that we are drafting off of Capitol Hill. We're not even drafting this on Capitol Hill. This is a bill that will bar lobbyists from giving money other than a de minimis amount, $100 every 2 years, in federal campaigns, including super PACs, including committees, including everything. It will redefine who a lobbyist is. You know, one of the great games of Washington is, who's a lobbyist? And I didn't realize, by the way, that was a game. I wish I had known. I wouldn't have been a lobbyist either. In fact, I wasn't. I actually, when my book came out, Newt, former congressman in the state, was running for president, and he was being attacked as the lobby. And so I was on some show, and they asked me, was Newt a lobbyist? And I said, well, yeah, I mean, really, I think so. He was lobbying. It seems he was lobbying. He was meeting with members of Congress discussing the health care bill and trying to persuade them. That's what a lobbyist does. So Newt was saying he was a history professor. So I said, well, I guess I was a history professor too. And so I decided to go look, finally, after this went back and forth. Of course, I, you know, got attacked by Newt's guys. Okay, whatever. And I went and looked at the Lobbying Disclosure Act. I went to look at the definition of what a lobbyist is, and I realized I wasn't a lobbyist either. Go figure. Nobody's a lobbyist. So we're going to tighten that up. Number two, that tightened up group can't give money. Number three, that group can't be involved in bundling contributions or in any way involved in raising money, putting on events, doing anything like that. Number four, their clients, the special interests, the people who hire them, corporations, labor unions, individuals, whoever wants something back for their money, can't give money. Make a choice. Either lobby and get something, okay, take your shot, or give money, not both. Finally, that the revolving door in Washington needs to be shut. As I mentioned earlier, I hired most of my people from Capitol Hill. I actually was the only lobbyist working for us who didn't work on Capitol Hill. Most of the people come to Capitol Hill, I would think 90% of the people who I lobbied wanted to work for me. Now, why do they want to work for me? Not because I'm just some good guy to work for. Because they can make a whole lot of money. They're making $170,000, $180,000 a year. The congressman, the staff is making less. The congressman comes over, they're going to make $1 million a year. The staff's going to make $300,000 a year. They want to be lobbyists. And these are the people drafting the bills to reform things. So do the math. So that the bill that we're working on closes the revolving door for 10 years. You work, you draw a check from the federal government. For 10 years, you can't do something that requires you to lobby, to register as a lobbyist. There's another component of term limits, which I'm very much in favor of. It wasn't when I was a lobbyist, of course, as I mentioned earlier. When you're a lobbyist, you don't want term limits in the same way that you don't go buy a new car every time you run out of gas. You just fill up your gas tank, right? So a congressman, you don't want to buy a new congressman every 6 years. You just want to keep giving enough contributions to keep the party going. The best congressman, senator for lobbyists in history was Strom Thurmond. He was there 100 years. Fantastic. They wheeled him out on a gurney. Perfect. Perfect. Okay? So, I've been working with reform groups and doing my best to go around and talk about this stuff. And I go to states, different states, and talk to their legislatures often. But it's not my business, you know. I don't like it when people come in from out of state and tell people what to do. And I don't want to tell anybody here what to do or anywhere what to do. I know DC. But these issues apply everywhere. And they're tough to do. And that's, by the way, one of the other reasons why having a senator who's actually willing, who A, understands all this, which is, to begin with, extraordinary, and B, doing something about it is unbelievable. Unbelievable. And is the hope for Georgia to not only not be at the bottom of the list, but to actually be at the top of the list. So it's very, very exciting and hopeful. So this is what I do now. I don't lobby, except everybody lobbies. What's lobbying? Lobbying is convincing people, right? Or persuading people, or advocating things. That's what lobbying is. When lobbyists use money to buy the result, that's the corruption. Lobbying itself isn't bad. So I lobby now as well. I don't lobby legislators. I go out and talk to people. And I've got to tell you, I've been on 300 radio and TV shows. Every week I'm out there, except for the people who live inside the Beltway and certain people who are involved in this kind of stuff. Not one person thinks this system is good and right. But the good news is there's so much anger out there. There's so much hostility to this. People are so upset about this that with the right plan and a pure plan, a plan where the problem is actually solved instead of Band-Aids, it's possible, in my view, maybe not this year, maybe not next year in terms of the federal side, but in a few years to actually solve this. And so for me, it's part recompense for having spent shamefully years in the system. It's part realizing this is the thing that needs to be done. And it's part a desire and a hope that this great country that we have, and it is a great country, can in fact survive in a way that we're all proud of it. Because I have to tell you, this particular ailment of corruption is at the root of almost all of our problems. It causes all of the people who are supposed to deliberate and cause and come to answers to our problems and come to solutions, rather, it causes them to get off the path. And just as the Bible says that bribery blinds the eyes of the wise, I don't know how wise they are, but it's certainly blinding their eyes. And so anyway, it's an honor for me to come and speak with you. All of you who get it intuitively, all of you who get it better than I got it until I had to get it. And so for me, it's not just an honor to be here with the senator and representative and with William, who is a hero, but all of you. And I can only hope and pray and encourage you to please do whatever you can do, because every one of us can change this, and it must be changed. Or our children and their children will not have a free country. It's that serious. So anyway, thank you for having me today. It's an honor.
And I love the line coming to America where they're like, you know, you're such a lovely audience, give yourselves a round of applause. That we want to give the opportunity to ask some questions. We've probably got time for about five or six or so. Hands went up quickly, so we're going to go with the first one I saw. Yes, sir. If you can tell us your name and how you heard about this.
Joe Karn. I'm a local elected official, actually, myself. And I understand that the gist of your bill will separate people that raise funds and contributors from lobbyists. You have to do one or the other. But my question is, I guess it's hard to pass something that both Democrats and Republicans majority of them really don't want to see pass. But okay, let's say you separate the money from the lodges. The people that give the money, now, one way or another, before they give you that money, they're going to transmit what it is they want or expect in one way or another. So won't they just kind of in turn become the de facto lobbyists?
No, no. Not only the lobbyists, but their clients as well. There's somebody seeking something from the government. If you're seeking something special, not a general interest, you know, I want clean air, I want relations with Canada to be nice, you know, I want there to be a national day for praising people who don't jaywalk. I mean, things like that. Those are general interests, specific special interests. I want a tax cut for my company, my industry. I want to have a grant. I want to have a loan, that kind of thing. That is the class who, in addition to their lobbyists, would also be barred. You did raise at the beginning of the question, just how is this possible that these guys might possibly vote away their system of perquisites that they enjoy? The truth is they aren't going to do it willingly. They're going to do it only by being forced. So part of the effort we're engaged in is not just crafting a bill. We're going to craft a bill, and we're going to solicit in 2014, we're going to find what we hope will be six congressional districts, three where the Republican is in favor of the bill and the Democrat is opposed, and three where the opposite. And we are going to pour everything into those districts from all over the country. Every show I've been on, gosh, everything from Sean Hannity and Michael Savage on the right to Travis Smiley and Bill Maher on the left. Every host that I've been on their show at the end says, I want it, I want to help. So there's a massive force out there that wants this. And what we hope to do is direct that army right into six districts in 2014 and to beat six folks.
Make an example.
Then to say in 2016, we're going for 50 districts. And then after the 2016 race, I don't know if it's 50 districts, but let's say we got 20 districts. Members of Congress don't understand, I'm not going to give you any more money. That is not a phrase they understand. When I was a lobbyist, I never thought, ever say to anybody, if you don't do what I want, I won't give you any money. Why? They walk out of their office and they're going to trip over five or six lobbyists with checks, shoving them into their pockets. There's not a lack of money. The one thing that they understand is losing their seat. That is the only thing they understand. Because no matter how much money they have, if they're out, they're out. And so what we are planning is to direct all the fire into a few districts, then expand it, and then basically say, listen, now after 2016, we've gotten X amount of heads on the spike, okay? We're going to put this bill through. You don't want to put it through? In 2018, we're coming for 300 a year, and we're going to beat you. And this is a right-left issue, by the way. Nothing is going to happen in Washington unless the right and the left agree. That's just reality, okay? But the right and the left do agree. I'm on the right. The people I work with are on the left. People on the right are not in favor of bribery. They're not in favor of cashing in. They're not in favor of this. People on the left are not either. The people who are in favor of this are Republicans and Democrats in Washington who are benefiting from it. And it is not philosophical. It is greed. And so that's how we're hoping to do this.
All right. Stephanie.
You mentioned that, I think it was Congressman May is a friend of yours. And
please introduce yourself.
I'm Stephanie Stuckey Benfield. I'm a recovering politician. And when I was in the State House, I know there were several votes where I'd look at some of my colleagues and say, how could you vote for that? I know you don't like that issue. And they'd say, oh, well, that lobbyist from Georgia Power, wherever, they're my friend. And I would always say, guess what? They're not your friends.
Right.
So my question for you is, when the scandal erupted and you went to prison, how many of these friends, actually, did any of them call, write, visit?
Well, they couldn't call me in prison, but I did. Yeah. I mean, I had some friends in Congress who I knew from way back in the college walking days and Reagan days, and they stayed friends. Most of the congressmen, they're politicians, all right? And there are exceptions, okay? There are exceptions, but our sages wrote 2,000 years ago the following, which, of course, I ignored as well, which was, if you be careful of politicians, because when they need you, you're their friend. and when you need them, they're gone. I actually told that to Kevin Spacey and the director to put in the movie. I don't know if you all saw this ridiculous film, but you know that they had me teaching a Bible lesson where actually my Bible lesson was that God wants us to be liquid. I don't know what that means. I mean, I don't know, it's maybe a premonition of another flood or something. I have no idea. But anyway, I told them to use that.
Yes, sir. I was going to ask you, I applaud you on what you're doing. This is awesome. I look forward to reading about it. But also, what are your thoughts on the super PACs and the Citizens United bill? Because it seems like one person, I mean, if I'm worth $10 billion, I can control numerous elections. A good example is Chicago yesterday. One rich guy put in, whether right or wrong, put in $2 million to support one candidate, and that candidate won.
Yeah.
Who wasn't the front runner originally. So now you deal with right and left, so you have freedom for growth. You know, you're going to have the guy admit before the election starts that I'm going to support what you support, and they're going to pump millions of dollars into that race. Right. That's what's happening.
Well, I mean, there it's, first of all, the Citizens United decision is a very textured and complex decision. And do I believe in unlimited free speech? I mean, except for where you're causing damage is danger. Yes, I do. Do I believe that speech is other than just words? I do. Okay, I do, philosophically. Do I believe that individuals as groups have rights as well as individuals? I do. The problem I have with Citizens United was I believe that the justices, none of whom is a politician, by the way, I don't think they understand the corrosive effect of money in the system. I mean, I'm sorry to make an arrogant statement like that. They're obviously brilliant men and women. They really are. But for them to basically posit that this is not inducing corruption, I think is wrong, okay, is wrong. So what we are crafting, by the way, would survive, we believe, Citizens United. Trevor Potter, the former head of the FEC and a brilliant constitutional lawyer, is the one leading our legal team, which includes Larry Lessig at Harvard and others, to craft something that would survive this court and Citizens United, but still solve what we think will be the problem. The problem, in my view, in some part isn't the fact that there's unlimited money in the system. The problem is that the money in the system is itself corrupt. The money is coming from people who want things back. If you take them out of the system, if you remove those who want something back, you're going to have very little of this money left, including, by the way, from the super PACs. Everything we're doing is geared not just to the campaigns, because you sell the campaigns and you leave the super PACs, you've done nothing. You've done nothing. So it's geared to both. The PACs, the campaigns, the super PACs, the political parties, and everything. If you look at the people who give massive amounts of money in our system, almost all of them have lobbyists and are busy trying to get something and are leveraging that money to make much, much more money. By the way, political investment, lobbying investment, these are great investments. The return on dollars from our efforts were in the tens of thousands of percentages, okay, depending on the client. So that needs to be stopped. Now, if that is stopped, then the issue of somebody lives in Montana and they're a trillionaire and they want to put all their money in the election. I don't know that there is that person out there. They don't have something they want back. I don't know who that is. We've been looking at this, trying to find among the big donors, who is the person who wants nothing back? We have yet to find one, on the left or the right, by the way. So taking them out is key.
I'm going to say real quick, earlier today, we talked about people lobbying and the efforts and things like that, and you should be a lobbyist if you're compensated for it, but if you're doing something that's in your heart, you're volunteering for it, you shouldn't be a lobbyist. That kind of hit me, and so I want to do something from my heart real quick, because one of the most brilliant things I think Jack Abramoff has ever done is married a woman that went to the University of Georgia. But we do happen to have a group of young Democrats that drove down from Athens tonight to be here. So I wanted to see if any of them had a question to step up with next. Yes, sir. Can you tell us your name?
My name is Beslan Simonov, and I'm with the Young Democrats group here, which is a great group, by the way. So. I just wanted to ask, What skills that you developed and you used in your previous calling do you still use today? What skills came in most handy then and come in most handy now?
You know, I've had probably 10,000 questions asked of me. That's the first time somebody asked me that question. The other question, by the way, just before I get to that, that I had not been asked before was, what was my nickname in prison? At least this one is a go. I didn't have a nickname in prison, by the way. I was one of poor, unfortunate prisoners without a nickname. You know, a lobbyist, the skills that a lobbyist needs, at least where I was, obviously you have to be able to learn every detail of your issue. Not only your side, but the other side. You've got to know your arguments and all of their arguments. Because lobbying is access and persuasion. Get to the person making the decision and then be persuasive. Now, the perversion of it takes place in the access part for the most part, because access gained through buying access is the problem. But once you get in the room, even if you have access, you've got to be able to make a case. You can't make a case if you don't know the case. So studying and learning every facet of the issue is very important, especially with most legislators don't have time to learn every issue. And many of them rely, and not improperly, by the way, on lobbyists to provide them information about the issue, as long as they understand that they're going to get one tilted side of it. So that's very important. So advocacy skills are very important, and they're important today, and they're important every day for everyone, everywhere. They were important in prison. Yeah, I'm trying to convince the gang to not, do whatever they were going to do. So the advocacy skills, I think, are probably, in terms of access, those skills probably are best left aside from, at least for me, for current activity.
I'm going to take one more, and I see the gentleman in the back standing up, keeps his hand up. So that's persistence is key. Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Abramoff, I respect your point of view on the unlimited campaign contributions, because I sometimes have conflicted feelings on that too, even though I oppose the Citizens United ruling, and I'm really worried about what they're going to do with this guy in Alabama that thinks he ought to be able to give unlimited directly to the parties and to the candidates. On the other hand, Labor was just as much for giving unlimited campaign contributions as, say, the Chamber of Commerce types.
Right.
But how do you separate the issue of campaign contributions from gifts? Because Adelson, given all the money, he wanted something in return. It's just, how do you separate the two, notwithstanding the fact that we got legal hurdles to overcome, and Senator McCoon did a lot to help explain the difference legally between the gift limits and campaign contribution limits. But I'm all for what you're doing. Absolutely. I'd rather have half of what we need two of than none. But how do you separate the corrosive influence of campaign contributions, especially if a lot of them are structured, and how to attack that legally, I don't know, where you can't even tell who's contributing. So that's
you can't tell who's contributing because there's no
Well, the 501(4)s or the, there's right. some
okay,
mechanism
so,
in
one
which...
One of the components that I didn't raise was the issue of 501(c)(4)s and 501(c)(3)s. Which have of late, when I ran 501(c)(4)s, we weren't permitted to engage in electioneering. We were only allowed to lobby. I also had 501(c)(3)s. These are tax exempt organizations, and we were only permitted to do educational stuff. If we had mentioned the candidate's name, that was a real problem. But so what's happened now is that the walls have broken down. And you have C4s are actually engaging in electioneering. So part of the bill, I didn't go into every little part of it, but part of it is to restore that wall so those groups can't do it. In terms of the gifts and in terms of the contributions, I think it's essential that those who are working on this issue continually draw the discussion back to the core discussion, which is, if you're seeking something from the government and you give a public servant anything of financial value, you have bribed them, okay? If you keep drawing it back to that, then it's not a discussion about loopholes, because a loophole still gets you into the red zone. It's how do we get rid of bribery? Not bribery statutorily, because the statute of bribery, I wasn't guilty of bribery, by the way. I pled to conspiracy to bribery. Okay, now there's a very important distinction there. Bribery, for to be bribery, I would have had to say, here, Congressman, it's $50,000. I want you to do X for this $50,000. And the congressman said, yes, I'm going to do X for this $50,000. Thank you for this $50,000. And we film it, and then we hand it in jointly to the Justice Department. That's never happening, right? So, but the fact is, it's still bribery. It's still bribery. And so I think that advocates of reform keep coming back to the core principles. When we do this campaign, we are going to empower the people who are running against those who will not support the bill with the following messages. Number one, at a debate, okay? I'm candidate A, candidate B wouldn't sign on. I ask candidate B, how come you won't agree not to be bribed? Number two, how come you won't agree not to cash in later? Number three, how come you won't agree to come home and not stay there forever? Now, what does candidate B answer to those things? So the more we draw back to the core, the easier it will be, and we don't have to worry about the distinction between gifts and contributions. They are the same thing. They are just different forms.
So a round of applause for that. Activist Ed has been incredibly generous. If no one, if you didn't get a book yet or you would like a picture, I think we'll send you back to the back table for a quick snap of a picture, a quick signing of the book, and we'll wrap it up. So thank you very much and appreciate it. I do want to recognize a couple of people. And first, never said, could you imagine that you would come to the Carter Center and hear from the producer of Red Scorpion, a movie with Dolph Lundgren? I mean, that's man of man.
You brought one.
Here you go. But real quick, if you're standing, if you could raise your hand. If you're sitting, if you could stand. I just want to recognize as a group our sponsors for tonight. If you're a sponsor for tonight, could you either please stand or please give us a wave. I know there's a few of you here. And those with our alliance partners, the Alliance for Ethics Reform, if you could stand and give a wave and let us thank all of you. If you're a board member or have been a board member of Common Cause Georgia, who allow me to do things like this, and I'm so appreciative of it, if you could stand or wave, board members or former board members. We're going to give a special nod to our current board chair, John Senton. Leslie Ward, right over here. You always have a dear place in my heart because she hired me. So thank you very much, Leslie. And then staff and interns for Common Cause who really do all the work. And then finally, the last group, if you're married to me, for putting up with somebody who can only go full throttle and keep you out on nights like this and things like that. Thank you very much. Just to close, again, I want to encourage you as much as I can to fill out a card, even if it's just with your email address to let us get in touch with you. If you're able and can donate and become a member of Common Cause Georgia, you'll help us more than you know. And the final thought is that, you know, we talked a lot about the gift caps and the gift bans. The fact of the matter is, this summer, 83% of Georgians, 87% in the Republican Party, 73% in the Democratic Party, voted to limit lobbyist gifts. And I'm not a very good lobbyist, even though I'm a registered lobbyist, so I've been taking a few lessons. Listen to the mayor of Atlanta, you'll hear that I'm not a very good politician. Because there are often times when I just can't stand up and say what they've done is incredible. The AJC described it as a historic bill. And it has its place in history. But for any member of the House to have the audacity to stand up and say, after 83% of you voted to limit lobbyist gifts, to allow exceptions that continue unlimited giving in the state of Georgia after all we've been through and the embarrassment of what we've had, it's inexcusable. Amen. And we need your help to defeat this.
So you do movies and stuff like that?
I'll post it on YouTube.
That's a clear cut. Whereas the other is, you know, depends on what judge. We have a talent, but I care about that.
He asked a question I wanted to ask, but he asked it a while ago. I came up to him afterwards and said that
Well, because I noticed that during these primaries right now, even here in Georgia, they're already jockeying for who can line up Freedom for Growth, American, you know, whatever the pack is. So they're obviously promising something.
Ryan's going to take a pass.
Yeah.
I acted like you recognized me before.
I learned a lot of athletics when you were running brothers. I'm going to watch this episode. We're in school at the same time. Not yet,
baby. Can we? Will it be?
I live in Brooklyn. Well, he lives off Aperture.
Yeah. It's possible. It's possible. Yeah, I think it's pretty.
Yeah, it's going to be
hard. Are you a lawyer?
I didn't bring
it. And maybe thanks for all you did today. I'm not sure anybody wants to see more pictures of you, but I really appreciate it. Thank you. Thanks for taking the whole day. Also,
I'm glad to have you.
Christmas party. I miss it.
I'm certain they will find it before I do. So, but I will look for it underneath.
Has he told you about people asking who's getting things?